Welcome, church.
Good morning.
Good to see everybody. Move that target out of the way. I've named this, "What Glory Are You After?" And I intend in this little talk today to present to you the pattern of Jesus Christ. Because he is the way, the truth, and the life, and there is no other. Absolutely no other. This scripture here says, "Thus saith the Lord, the heaven is my throne, the earth is my footstool." Does that mean he has possession of everything?
Yeah.
All is his, isn't it? "Where is the house that ye build unto me, and where is the place of my rest?" What is the purpose of God creating man? Why did he create us?
His pleasure.
Pardon me?
His pleasure.
His pleasure.
Fellowship.
Fellowship. But a fellowship that we don't even really, I think, understand. Because when God says, "You build a house for me," he wants to dwell in us, not just with us. Do you understand that? That's the reason that Jesus created man. That he could have intimate fellowship with us. Into me see. That's what God wants from all of us. "For all those things that my hand made, and all those things have been, saith the Lord, but to this man will I look, even to him that is poor and of a contrite spirit and trembleth at my word." What does that mean? A reference. Definitely a reference, right? And an attentive ear, right? Somebody who's hearkening. I like that old word, hearken. I do well when I hearken to my wife's voice, because she said to me, "Good morning." She said, "That thing needs to be shaved a little bit." And it's gotten long enough where the little mustache hairs go up my nose and they tickle me. So I should have listened to it. Anyways, who is the star of your show, brothers and sisters? Who's the star? I hope it's God. Or maybe he's just a supporting actor. And maybe you're the star of your own show. I think we all have to ask ourselves that question. What we're going to discuss here today is glory. Glory. Because that's who God is, isn't he? Mm-hmm. Isn't he glory? What is glory?
Light.
The Webster's Dictionary says public praise, honor, fame. Who gets it today, brothers and sisters? Who gets that? Football players, maybe? Maybe even evangelists, preachers, maybe. Huh? Hollywood actors? Maybe even soul winners, huh? Let's turn our Bibles to Peter, way back there towards the back. Peter 3 and 18. It's like the old Dodge. Second Peter 3 and 18. When you get there, just say amen. "But grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to him be glory, both now and forever." So to him should be all the glory. That's what the Bible says, right? That's not my words. Let's turn to Ephesians. A little bit to the left. Ephesians 3 and 7. Y'all get there to say that.
Amen.
All right. "Wherefore I was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of his power. I just want you to know as I'm reading there, it's 11:56. You guys just got me up here. So. Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world has been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ, to the intent that now the principalities and powers and heavenly places might be known by the church, the manifold wisdom of God, according to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by the faith of him. You hear that? That's very clear, isn't it? Not faith in, but the faith of him. Is there a difference, brothers and sisters?
Yes.
So what is the difference? Because most of the world just believes, I gotta just believe in Jesus, and then I just live my life any way I want to, and I'll be in heaven, right? Cool. Is that what the scriptures teach? Or the scriptures teach something deeper? That we must have the faith of Jesus. See, Jesus died for all men, so all men are justified. But are all men going to be sanctified? How do we get sanctification? By Christ in you. You are in Christ because he died for your sins. But for Christ to be in you, that's the hope of glory, brother.
Yeah.
That's a different matter. Wherefore I desire that ye faint not at my tribulations for you. Listen to that verse. My tribulations for you, which is what?
Your glory.
How many of us can take that counsel to heart? Our glory is tribulations. That's what the Bible just said, didn't it? So what do we do when we face tribulations? We complain and we murmur. Right? Oh God, why did you do this to me? Right? When what is he doing? He's hewing and perfecting our characters, right? Fitting us for heaven. Isn't that what he's doing? You know, back in the old Jewish economy, when they were building the sanctuary, they made all this noise at the quarry, right? So the stones were taken to the sanctuary. There was no noise. The sanctuary stones were just put into place. You see, this earth is the quarry, brothers and sisters. This is where we get chopped. This is where we get hewn. This is where we get polished so that God can take us and fit us into the kingdom where he has us by faith right now.
Amen.
Only one right now. Amen.
Amen.
I mean, come on. I mean, that's something to get excited about. By faith, God has already wrote your name. I mean, the book of Revelation says it. You know, I block your name out. What does that mean? It means that it's already there. You make the decision, brothers and sisters. God has casted the vote for you. He's done it all. I want to read you something here from the commentary. And this right here is a very good read. I'm just going to read it to you. In Christ dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead. But the only way in which he could reach men was to veil his glory by a garb of humanity. The angels beheld the hiding of his glory. The divinity might touch humanity. Christ ever retained the utmost hatred for sin, but he loved the purchase of his blood. He suffered in the place of sinful men, taking them into union with himself. This is the mystery into which angels desire to look. Is that beautiful? They desired to know how Christ could live and work in a fallen world. How he could mingle with sinful humanity. It was a mystery to them that he who hated sin with intense hatred felt the most tender, compassionate sympathy for the beings that committed sin. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Whew. We serve an awesome God. You stop and think about that. Now, he didn't just veil his glory for a moment in time. Jesus has taken on a body forever. Do you understand that? He has lifted humanity to such a place that it's mind-blowing.
Amen.
He has made your bank account so rich that you couldn't cash the check. I mean, there's so much money you couldn't spend it on. His righteousness is so full, and he's so willing to give it to you. But how willing are you to let go of the things that you hold on to so that you can't take what he has for you? Here's the problem. We're just like little monkeys. You know? Little monkey's favorite food, the coconut, right? Well, whatever. They like coconuts too. You cut a hole in a coconut, he sticks his hands in there, and he grabs it, right? And he can't get out. If he was smart enough to let go of the coconut, he could slip back out, but he's too greedy. It's the way we are. You can't hold on to sin and have Jesus too. It was worth the laugh, wasn't it? You gotta be willing to allow yourself to be. Jesus was. Look how humiliated he was. Are you willing to be humiliated for Jesus Christ? Really? Because if you're gonna live in this world and you're gonna stand for Jesus, you are going to be humiliated.
Yes.
There's no doubt about it. If everybody's your buddy, then you better check up your life. You really better check it out. The Bible says when everybody speaks well of you, whoa, whoa, whoa. Revelation 14. Let's go there. Revelation 14. I'm going to start in verse 1. And I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his father's name written in their foreheads. What in the world does that mean? Having his father's name written in their forehead. Anybody?
In their mind.
Okay. Definitely in their mind.
Ownership.
Ownership. Isn't this character? Isn't this character, brothers and sisters? This is what we're talking about. What are you going to leave this world with? Because I've never seen a U-Haul follow a hearse. What are you taking with you? You're taking your character, brothers and sisters. And that's what's getting developed. That's what God is working on, if you'll allow him the space. He's a perfect gentleman. Listen, this is what you hear if you're listening. Because you know what? We tune everything out. Since a baby, you've had a heartbeat, okay? And that heartbeat is loud. And we all got loud heartbeats in here. But you know what? We don't hear them because we tune them out. If I was to put all of you individually in a soundproof room, some of you would really start freaking out because you'd begin to hear things and you'd be like, what in the world is that? Because there's nothing else in here but me, and all of a sudden I'm here. Your own heartbeat that you haven't heard in years. What am I trying to say here? We tune everything out, brothers and sisters, even the loved ones that we have. We're so used to hearing them and being there, that we take things for granted. Amen. We really do. We take each other for granted. And you know, many of you get caught up in stinking thinking. You allow the devil to put a terrible thought in your mind, and you hold on to it. Why in the world would you do that? Let it go. Get rid of it. Jesus would never hold on to stinking thinking. You don't think the devil didn't try to put all that stuff in his brain? He didn't give him a nail to hang it on. Do you follow me? You don't have the right to screw with yourself in that way. That's what I'm trying to say to you. God loves you. He cares about you. So don't do that stuff. I know a lot of people that are just prone to depression and being just upset. Why? What happened? I'll tell you what happened. They allowed stinking thinking to happen. There are people that have chemistry in their brains that are, stuff happens. And they may need medication. I don't know. I'm not a doctor. But for the most part, you know, people, if we look to Jesus and keep our eyes focused on the pattern, these problems fall away by the wayside. Everything goes exactly where it needs to be. You know, Martin Luther used to say if he didn't spend 3 hours on his knees in the morning, he couldn't get nothing done. How many of you spend 3 hours on your knees in the morning? Or even would think to make a statement like that? Wow. Why? He was absolutely sure that he was sure that he was full of the Holy Spirit before he'd leave the house. You know what I'm saying? How much do you think you can get done with God directing your path? I mean, say I'm going to buy a house or I'm going to do something, and I think, wow, this is great, great deal. I got the money and da-da-da-da-da. I go buy the house, and the next day a tornado takes it away. But if I'd have been listening to God, he'd have said, don't buy that house. Hello? My whole life savings just went. Stop and think about it. What do you got to lose? The King of the universe is on your side.
Amen.
Verse 7, let's skip on down to verse 7. Saying with a loud voice, this is Revelation 14 and 7. Saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. What does that word is mean?
Here,
now. Doesn't it? And worship him that made the heavens and the earth and the sea and the fountains of water. Whew. It says it is come. That means it's happening now, brothers and sisters, isn't it? The judgment in heaven is going on today as we speak. And God isn't even bothering to judge people that don't even claim him because they're already condemned. Do you think this is serious work that's happening right now?
Yes.
We're living in the anti-typical day of atonement. Period. God's people ought to be serious about these kind of things. Revelation 15 and 8. And the temple was filled with smoke from the glory of God and from his power, and no man was able to enter into the temple till the seven last plagues of the seven angels were fulfilled. The temple was filled with smoke. What kind of awesome glory do you suppose is there? I'm not even going to try to go there. I'm just going to leave that. That's out of my pay grade, brothers and sisters. Revelation 21, 23. And the city had no need of the sun, neither of the moon to shine in it. Doesn't say that they don't have it. It says they have no need of it. For the glory of God did lighten it, and the Lamb is the light thereof. Glory of God. So we're talking the glory of God is so powerful that we don't need the sun or the moon in heaven. Is that pretty amazing? I try to fathom God's glory and try to understand it. I can't even get my mind around the fact that the sun has been burning for 6,000 years and where does it get refueled? How in the world does it stay there? These are just things that make me go, huh? I mean, I gotta go, I go 1,000 miles, I gotta refuel my truck, it's out of fuel. It doesn't just mysteriously have fuel in it again. How does the sun continue to burn? Continually. We're talking 6,000 years, brothers and sisters. This is a big hot fire. How does that happen?
Oh, it just, you know, just happened.
Glory.
Amen, brother. Amen. Okay. Let's go. God's glory is his character. Let's turn to Exodus, way back towards the front of your Bible. Exodus in chapter 15. Exodus in 15. When you get there, say amen. And said, if thou will diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God. What does that mean, to diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God? Yeah, pay attention. Listen up. Listen, if we really truly love somebody, don't we listen? Don't we listen? You know what my problem is? I, way back, not that I don't listen to my wife, and just she's back there laughing. But I don't listen well enough. I don't. And why is that? I mean, when we first got together, man, I'll tell you what, I drove people crazy talking about this woman. They'd say, shut up already. Okay? And I'd listen to everything she said, and I didn't miss a word. Now I miss a few words. I do. But I'm not, I know you guys are laughing, but it's not funny. That shows bad on me. I'm not loving my wife the way I should. I should be listening to her. And you know, I've found, it's weird to say, because just women are different anyway, but when I repeat back to her what she said to me, she just seems to blow. Because she really knows that I'm listening. And that means so much. I'm telling you guys, this will work. I mean, when your wife knows that you're listening to her, man, she is excited. There's no better way we can show love to our wives. And God is saying right here, if my page didn't turn, the wind, here we go. And said, if thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and will do that which is right in his sight. And how can I not do that which is right in his sight if I'm diligently hearkening unto a God that I love, that I want to please?
Amen.
And will give ear to his commandments and keep all his statutes. What does it mean to keep all his statutes? It means to cherish and protect, doesn't it? That's what it means. Everybody thinks it's a list of do and don't. That's not it at all. This stuff is easy if we do it right. If we do it God's way rather than man's way, and all this tradition, and fall into a robot mode, listen to the rest of these verses. This is amazing. I will put none of these diseases or diseases upon thee, which I have brought upon the Egyptians, for I am the Lord that healeth thee.
Amen.
Wow.
Amen.
Is that an amazing statement? Amen. Stop and think about that. What if these people did exactly as he said? Do you remember when the Bible talked about these people in 40 years in the desert, there wasn't a sick or feeble one among them? Their shoes didn't even wear out. Their clothes didn't wear out. How do you do that in the hot sun in the desert? And you're fed even in the desert. What kind of God do we serve, brothers and sisters?
Amen.
Why don't we listen? Why don't we believe? Why don't I love my wife enough to really listen to every word? I'm confessing to you, my love. That's what I'm doing. And I won't get it right. Exodus 33. Exodus 33 and 18. we're going to talk a little about, a bit about Moses right now. In 18, Moses says to God, and he says, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. Show me thy glory. And God says, and he said, I will make all my goodness pass before thee. I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee. The name of the Lord. Did you hear that? That's his glory, the name of the Lord. And will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and will show mercy on whom I will show mercy.
Amen.
Let's turn our, over to 34, probably one page over for y'all, and beginning in verse 6. And the Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, giving iniquity and... Wait a minute. Keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children unto the third and fourth generation.
Amen.
This is amazing stuff. And Moses made haste and bowed his head toward heaven and worshipped. And he said, if now I have found grace in thy sight, O Lord, let my Lord, I pray thee, go among us. For it is a stiff-necked people, and pardon our iniquity and our sin, and take us for thine inheritance. And he said, behold, I make a covenant before all thy people. I will do marvels such as not been done in all the earth, nor in any nation, in all the people which thou art seen, shall see the work of the Lord, for it is a terrible thing that I will do with thee. Observe thou that which I command thee this day. Behold, I, this is God doing, not us doing, right? God doing, I will drive out before thee the Amorite, the Canaanite, the Hittite, the Perizzite, the Hivite, and the Jebusite. Is God going to fight your battles? Isn't that what it's saying here? He's taking care of it all. Everything. And what is he asking us to do? Take heed to thyself, lest thou make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land whither thou goest, lest it should be a snare in the midst of thee. Whew. We shouldn't make alliances with people that God says not to make alliances with, huh? Amen. Make a deal with the devil. And then it says on, but ye, that's our doing, shall destroy the altars, break their images, and cut down their groves. Why are we doing that? God's having us do that, so, not because he can't do it, because he wants to show us. That's why. Okay. How do we give God something he already has? How do we do that? How do we give God glory? We're talking about a God that is glory. So how do we, as brothers and sisters, give glory to God?
Like him.
That's giving shame.
What's that?
Sharing with other people.
By allowing him to reflect his glory off from us. See, he's like the sun, and we're like the moon. The moon has no light of its own, as we have no light of our own. But we only show the light that God gives us. That's it. That's all that we have. In Exodus 34, 29, you're still there, I hope. And it came to pass, when Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tables of testimony in Moses' hand, when he came down from the mount, that Moses wist not that his that the skin of his face shone while he talked with him. Wow. What does that mean? What does that mean? His face shone. He shined like a diamond, didn't he? He shined like the sun. Was this his own doing? No. What was he doing? He was reflecting
the glory of God.
Pardon me?
He was reflecting the glory of God.
He was reflecting the glory of God. Absolutely right. And then in 30 it says, and when Aaron and the children of Israel saw Moses, behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come nigh him. And Moses called unto them and to Aaron, and all the rulers of the congregation returned unto him, and Moses talked with them. And afterward all the children of Israel came nigh, and he gave them in commandment all that the Lord had spoken with him on Mount Sinai. Until Moses had done speaking with them, he put a veil on his face. They couldn't handle it. They couldn't handle it. He had to have a veil on his face because they couldn't take it. Is that amazing?
Mm.